to the Vintage Podcast. It's been a minute. Now, I had a little plan in mind for this podcast. I have two guests with me in the studio today. We've got Mia.
Say hi,
Mia. And we've got Lily.
Hello. Hi.
So I realised when I first started working in Vintage, the kind of huge wealth of expertise and bookish know-how in the office. It was incredible. And I thought it would be a shame not to share that with the world. Everyone in the office seems to have an area of confidence and an area of nerves. Like, you can go to different people at different times. An area where they're like, yes, I can tell you everything about this author or this topic. And other ones where they're like, oh, I don't really know. Please don't ask me. In this series, which I'm going to be calling Hello, I'm Scared Of, for reasons we will explain in a minute, won't we, Lily? We'll be bringing in two vintage bookworms from the team. One who is scared of a certain author, topic or genre. No need to nervously giggle, Lily.
Sorry.
And one who is willing to have their brain picked. We're going to be unpacking some of the best writing before your eyes in the hopes that afterwards you want to give it a try too. So, Lily, can you tell me the origin story of this podcast? Tell me how I got this idea.
Oh, lordy.
Okay. Well, it was late and I decided that I was actually going to go home. But I was thinking, what am I going to read on my commute home? Which is something that I enjoyed doing. And often I will pick up a little booklet from around the office. And
it's a serious question when you live in London as well. I'm like, I'm stuck with this book for at least an hour.
Exactly, yeah, exactly. And I'd been sort of thinking about what to try next. And it just sort of came out, really, that I saw that Mia was also still there. And I knew that Mia was something of an expert, I think, on poetry. And I'm sure we're going to find out even more so. And so I suppose the title comes from just what I said to her when I was thinking about what to read that evening, and I just said to her, hello, I'm scared of poetry, what would you recommend? And Leena overheard this, and her brain being what it is, decided
content
to make it into a podcast.
Because Mia was giving such good recommendations,
yeah,
and making you feel so good about it, and I thought it's that thing of just like everybody has something,
yeah,
where they feel like intimidated, especially I think because we've had so many generations of classics now that it's really, if you look back and you feel like you need to know everything about a genre or an author or the origin story of a certain kind of trope, it's just it's too much. It's a lot. Mia, do you want to tell us what your involvement is with poetry at Vintage and what you do?
Yeah, so I am basically the poetry specialist at Vintage within the publicity team. So that basically means that I work on all of the poetry collections that we publish, making sure that they secure review coverage, organising events and tours, and generally just getting to hang out with a lot of really cool contemporary poets.
Your job is so cool.
Yeah, I love it.
It's my favourite part of my job.
Mia, can you tell me how you got into poetry? Like, what was your first in? Like, what made you want to specialise in that?
Well, I've really liked poetry ever since I was little, and I think I had a bit of a slightly unique upbringing in that I was read poetry as a child. Mm. Not like, my parents weren't like reading out The Wasteland to me in the crib.
It's basically child cruelty, probably.
Just like Philip Larkin poems about pavements and sadness.
Well, there's that Philip Larkin poem, isn't there? Like, your parents, they really fuck you up.
Yeah,
Which, you know, every poet listening to this now is going to roll their eyes.
Yeah.
To be mentioning that, but yeah. But yeah, I was kind of introduced to poetry at a quite young age, and not necessarily like, you know, really big poems, but just things like Spike Milligan's kind of nonsense poetry, which really is just like an experiment with sound. So I never felt like poems had to have one particular meaning. I just enjoyed the sound of them and listening to them, and so it's something that kind of followed me through my education. I always really enjoyed reading poetry then. When I went to university, I did a specialist course in modern poetry, which barely really scratched the surface of modern poetry, but, you know, it was a great introduction. And I did a few bits of surrealist poetry. So that's kind of how that had come about. And then basically, when I was the assistant at Vintage, the publicity assistant, we had this amazing collection come in on submission. It was called Night Sky with Exit Wounds by a poet called Ocean Vuong. And I'd heard about it, and then I read it, and it just blew me away. And I basically said to Jo, who was our publicity director, please, 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 can I help you? And because he was getting married, it kind of turned out that it worked a little bit better that I got to do the campaign. But so, yeah, and that went quite well. And then I think it kind of gave the publicity team a bit of trust with me with poetry. And they kind of said, look, you clearly really enjoy this. You clearly know more about it than perhaps some of the rest of us. Would you like to take this forward as a project? And I was like, yes, please. That's what I was angling for.
Like, this is my destiny. I will take it up. I'm taking up the sword. Lily, you perhaps have an origin story of poetry that's a bit more similar to mine, and then you're a little bit scared of it. Because I've kind of done like an English undergrad and an English master's, and I still look at poetry and I'm like, do I understand this? Am I getting what I'm supposed to get from this? Is this what does this mean? Is this good or bad? I can't tell.
Yeah.
Tell us how your interactions with poetry over the years and how you feel about it.
I mean, I was just sort of vigorously nodding my head then and realised that won't have come across on a podcast format. But yeah, I mean, like, very similar. I think theoretically I did study poetry as part of, you know, my English literature studying stuff. But it was never modern. It was always, you know, Donne, or it was Marvell, yeah, or whatever, you know, Shakespeare.
Rape and of the Lock.
Exactly. And you're like, oh, ha, 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 yeah, I get it. But it felt like a completely different thing somehow. I suppose, yeah, I feel like it was a semi-part of my education, but it was always kind of canon poems, and it was always thinking about how the poet had played with artifice or played with form. Mm-hmm. And it was very easy to somehow distance yourself as a kind of reader or listener from the poet. It was always like the speaker or the voice or the character in the poem. Mm. And something that I find really scary, I think, about modern poetry in particular, and I'm probably using like modern poetry as a term completely wrong, forgive me.
We're going to ask you what that is,
yeah,
in a second.
Yeah, please, because I didn't even could ask. You? Because, yeah, I guess something that I find scary about that as a thing is that it's more difficult somehow to kind of separate the poet from the poems, and so it just adds this kind of level of pressure somehow to, like, if the poet is bearing their soul and they're in the room and they're alive and they're telling you, you know, this is my deepest, darkest fear or hope or love, and here are the most, like, amazing words that I can think to try and say it in, and then you just read it and you're like, nah, mate, just doesn't, that didn't do anything for me. There's something so sort of deeply cringeworthy and awful, and I just feel very guilty about that. And I can't tell whether it's that I have no taste, and which is very likely, and whether it's that, you know, the poems are sort of going over my head somehow, or whether I am just too emotionally frigid to to accept,
Lily,
like, a poem where someone is just being like, this is something that really hurts me or something, and I just go like, no, I don't like this, thanks.
So you feel like the stakes are quite high and the level of autobiography is like, it feels like, should you respond to it as a reader or as like a sympathetic human, and like it's a confusing relationship?
Yeah, I think so. And I think with, say, a novel, I think because the poetry as a form is so minute and intense, and that's kind of the point, you know, it's like squash saturated. That's a really bad analogy. But, you know, it's so tiny and condensed and intense that, whereas, say, in a novel, you can kind of get on board with some bits and not with others, and it just feels less high stakes, less personal somehow.
That makes sense.
Whereas if a poem doesn't do what it seems to be trying to do, it just feels like, well, that's gone then. That hasn't been successful. I feel like it's either like a yes or a no in a way that novels maybe don't feel like. It's like a stand-up or something. A stand-up comedian saying a gag. If you don't laugh, that didn't work. And I feel like that's with poems, you know? Yeah. It's like, do you like it? Nope. Okay, there goes
that
one.
This is the thing, I think it's like it has such a power to succeed in an amazing way if it's right. But if it's wrong, you're like, oh, no.
Yes.
But yeah, Mia, how do you feel about that? Our very basic,
are you shaking your fist,
like,
at me?
The difference between kind of school poetry and that kind of like detached Victorian man talking about sex, but not really talking about sex. Or like, and then like the kind of modern autobiographical. Are we talking bollocks, basically?
We're not talking bollocks at all. I kind of see this is going to be an analogy some people might laugh at, but I kind of see poetry like, if you think about writing in terms of coffee, so like a novel might be like a latte or a cappuccino, but poetry is like an espresso shot.
Yes.
And I think one mistake that some people make is they try and take the espresso shot all in one, which you've ever done, is horrible, but it doesn't mean that an espresso shot isn't lovely. Mm. And I think sometimes people can think that a poem has to mean something to them in that moment, or it has to move them immediately while they're listening to it or watching it. But actually, I think one of the reasons I like poetry is I can read the kind of same 30 lines 20 times in my life, and each time I get something slightly different from it. So I think part of the problem is some people don't spend time with poetry.
Mm. No, and I think it's also this kind of like, we live in like a Goodreads world where it's like, what am I reading? How many can I read this week? Like, how, like, I've got to read. And again, I guess because I feel like I'm trained to read a novel, I'm like, I'll start at the beginning and I'll finish at the end. Then after that, I don't need to touch the book again. Whereas this, you're saying it's more kind of like you need to live alongside the poems and like,
like, rush them. Take them in. And like, I never read a poetry collection chronologically from start to finish. I kind of dip in and out of it. I might pick a random page to have a read of and then later on pick the same page up again or flick to another section. You don't quite have to read it in the same linear way that you would have to with a novel. The choice is kind of up to you.
I also think I'm very guilty in terms of that with, because I do tend to read on a commute or when I'm like semi doing something else because there's 24 hours. I think sometimes poetry needs space more and it needs your kind of attention in a way that I maybe don't give it sometimes, you know. So things I've read, poetry collections that I've tried to read recently where I've been like, no, Lily, snap out of it. Come on, read some poetry. It will be fine. It'll be good for you. Like medicine. I feel like I've been on the tube reading them and sort of been like, okay, I feel like you're referencing something that's gone over my head, or this emotion hasn't quite hit, or something. But when I've then actually gone back to it later on to either try and talk to someone about it, so say if someone's recommended it to me and I want to like tell them what I thought, I then go back to the poems sort of in the quiet of my room and actually go, oh, that's no, fair enough, that is actually quite good. And so I do wonder if it's just a kind of, maybe I need to find the right cafe to have my espresso in.
I think also, like, one of the most liberating things that ever happened to me with poetry reading was, I'm going to be really, like, a pastiche of myself here, and say, in a university lecture, in my first year of university, one of my lecturers kind of came storming in, and he was giving his kind of lecture on modern poetry, and he basically just said, poetry has no meaning. Like, none was like, and we were all there like,
release you from that now.
We were there like, of course it does. That's not what they said at GCSE or A level. And I was thinking like, oh my god, how? And I was angry for a long time. I was like, how dare he disrespect? But what he was trying to do was kind of liberate us from this feeling that we're missing something, or that like something has gone over our head. It doesn't have to mean one particular thing. And I think the more I read poetry, the more I realise no one poem means any single one thing to one person anyway. So I just think you don't have to kind of read it searching for meaning or searching for this revelation. Just kind of sit with it. See if there's a phrase that kind of speaks to you, or if it doesn't, you can put it down. Like, you don't feel like you should have to read poetry, because I don't think people feel the same way about, like, the latest novel at number one on the Sunday Times bestseller list. Like, you don't have to read that if it's not your cup of tea. Or, like, if crime's not your cup of tea, don't read a crime novel. In the same way, like, if you're not a person who enjoys poetry that might be seen as confessional or modernist, like, fine, that's not for you. You don't have to feel guilty about that in the same way that you wouldn't feel guilty about, I don't know, like, Jojo Moyes not being your cup of tea. Someone else will love Jojo Moyes. Clearly, thousands of readers do, because she's a best-selling novelist.
Yeah, I think there is also, because poetry is maybe still seen as this niche, there is not a very good understanding of kind of the genres within it, or, like, the different types of poetry within it. And so when you were saying that, I was thinking, well, I feel like I've kind of been telling myself, okay, I'm going to read some more poetry rather than, like, I'm going to read a thriller, you know, the equivalent of that.
Yeah.
And I wonder if maybe a way forward for me to try and be less scared would be to try and think more about kind of the different possibilities within poetry and maybe kind of try and find.
One thing that I found really helpful is reading anthologies. Mm, so just like collected work selected by someone who is an expert and their favourite poems on either a particular subject. So like I think Penguin have done really great ones on love or like just of a certain era. And just reading through that, and some of them, like, I'm like, oh, that poem's not for me. There are others where I've read something and I've gone, oh, that's blown me away. I'm going to buy that poet's collected works, for example.
Is there anything that you'd advise for people starting off reading poetry that's, like, you know, easy to digest a bit more if you're getting used to the form of poetry, stuff that you can sit with? And
There's an anthology that I really love called The Rattlebag. And that was collated by Ted Hughes and Seamus Heaney, who, if you aren't familiar with them, were both really great poets of the kind of 20th century. And that is just essentially all of their favourite poems from all of their favourite writers of their time. And it's really well chosen because obviously they really know their stuff. Mm-hmm. And there's some great stuff from Sylvia Plath in there and so on. So that is a nice kind of introduction. And then another one is the Forward Prize, which is basically a prize for kind of contemporary poetry. They have a prize for the best debut, a prize for best poetry collection, and like a prize for the best poem. And each year they do an anthology of the poems that kind of made it into the prize shortlist, and some that maybe didn't quite but were still brilliant. And they did a collection called 100 Prized Poems, and that was the best of the 25 years of the prize. So that is a really nice like snapshot into poetry over the last 25 years or so.
And who are some of your favourites? Like, they're not even accessible, but they're just brilliant. Like, they're the ones that we should be working towards being able to tackle.
Oh, it's such a personal taste thing. These are just the poets that I really enjoy as a reader, rather than me kind of saying this is someone you should have read.
Leah on the sofa, what she reads on a Saturday.
Yeah, like, that's what I want. Haven't read Middlemarch?
Yeah,
I've not read Middlemarch. No one's read Middlemarch.
I will tackle it.
I've read the Spartan
one day.
Maybe we should do a Hello, I'm scared of Middlemarch.
Oh yeah, God,
yeah. But what about please. The prep?
I will be the scared one it. Because I am scared of Middlemarch. But some of the ones that the poetry collections that I've really enjoyed recently, I really love Stag's Leap by Sharon Olds. Mm-hmm. She is kind of known as the great living confessional poet. And confessional just kind of means, like, it sounds like you're hearing a confession from somebody. Like what you were saying earlier, someone's deepest, darkest feelings. It doesn't necessarily have to mean that it is confessional. It's not necessarily like, this is Sharon Olds' fear of dying, for example. It might be, but a lot of the time it's a kind of performed character. But there's this great collection of hers called Stag's Leap, and it kind of predominantly deals with the dissolution of her marriage. And it won the T.S. Eliot Prize in 2012.
Fact checkers and calling in.
Fact checkers calling in. And I read that when I was about 18, and it just blew me away. I'd never been married, I'd never been divorced, never had children, but it just spoke to me. I mentioned before Ocean Vuong's collection. When that came in on submission, it completely blew me away. I love everything that Andrew McMillan writes. I worked on a collection called Vertigo and Ghost by Fiona Benson, which is a kind of really stunning exploration of ancient myth kind of through a modern lens, and it examines Zeus's reputation as a serial rapist, and it kind of touches on some kind of very contemporary moments. There are references to Trump, there are references to Brock Turner, the swimmer who was kind of given a light sentence because he was an exemplary member of the swimming team, air quotes. So it's really timely, really contemporary. That really kind of astounded me. There's an opening poem to that called Ace of Base, which kind of looks at the kind of starting of female sexuality, and it's just beautiful, and I related to that a lot, so I enjoyed that very much.
One thing that I did write down on my little app that was things that I thought, reasons I'm scared of poetry, and we've talked about a few of them, but one of them is just, I think, maybe the most basic thing, and maybe why most people who are scared of poetry are scared of it, is this feeling that it
is referencing something that you don't get, or that it is somehow kind of being very clever and going over your head. Is that just me? I sort of feel like maybe not so much this confessional style, but I just feel like in a lot of poetry that I seem to have read recently, I just don't get it. It's like there's a not even a kind of emotional disconnect, but literally like I don't understand why these words are coming together. And I suppose like I was recommended Anne Carson by someone, and I really wanted to love it, and I was just so looking forward to reading it because I was like, oh, this is going to be the one, you know, just people whose opinions you really trust. And I genuinely have no idea what this book is about. Like, I read it twice and I still just don't, it just doesn't make any sense to me. Cognitive, like, yeah. And I just, and I sometimes feel like maybe because poetry is maybe referencing things that are either very personal or maybe very specialist somehow, I sometimes worry that, am I reading this and not getting it because I'm being stupid? Or is this something that I should then look up? Or is this something that is like a almost like a poetry in-joke? You know, if they're like referencing another poet or something and I haven't read them, so I don't understand the reference and that kind of thing. I just wondered if you felt like that was something that always stays with you, even when you're comfortable with poetry. Do you still feel that you're sometimes, things are sometimes going over your head? Or, yeah, am I being paranoid for thinking that poetry is laughing at me?
I don't think poetry is laughing at you at all.
I think it is.
I just think it's very concentrated. The meanings are really kind of layered over one another with certain collections. And even as someone who's very comfortable with poetry, there are occasionally some things where something has kind of gone over my head. Occasionally, but I think that's fine because
I have
it
for
that.
A second.
I have that with novels sometimes. There are kind of some novels that I read where I'm like, I can see you're trying to do something, hasn't quite done it for me.
Yeah.
But I think with novels, we don't feel guilty about that. And for some reason that I can't quite put my finger on, sometimes people feel guilty about not having got a particular poem. But I think just treat it the same way you would treat any novel. Like, put it aside. Okay, that Anne Carson collection is not for you.
Sorry.
But there's one that I really like called Glass, Irony and God. And if I remember correctly, there's a kind of section at the very beginning that is kind of a long poem about the Bronte sisters. And if you've read the Brontes,
I think I have, yes. I'm not sure if I've ticked off all of them. I was just trying to think, isn't there one that's always forgotten about? And I think I have forgotten about her.
Yeah.
I know of Brontes as a concept.
But like that is a quite nice one too. But like, you know, maybe Anne Carson just isn't for you, but move on to someone else in the same way that someone might kind of say, like, I don't know, Ian McEwan's not for me, but I love Salman Rushdie.
Yeah.
I think also, like, all authors to some extent are, like, building on the past and, like, kind of, like, having read the canon or at least be, like, subconsciously aware of the canon and then writing something new out of it. And some authors and poets can really be explicit about that and be like, oh, here's my reference.
Yeah.
You know, and, like, trying to build on that explicitly, and then some people do it implicitly. So I guess it depends on the kind of poetry you find. And I think as well, like, there should be, like, more... Like, maybe it's something that I should do, but, like, I my favourite poet is Philip Larkin, and I love him so much. But I also think that part of the reason I love him is because I had an incredible, like, A-level teacher who explained so much of it to me that I then went back and enjoyed it more because he explained the historical stuff. So it's kind of like, it's also like sometimes I think if you pick up a novel, you're like, okay, this is all I need. This is my only bit of kit. But then sometimes it's made me want to go back and do that more for myself with other poets because I'm like, but maybe I love Philip Larkin because he's from the city I'm from Coventry. And then he also, you know, like I get some of his jokes now because I had to look them up.
And I do think there's a bit of a sense of sometimes with a novel, if you look at it too closely, if you try and unpick it too much, it falls apart and you actually lose its essence. Whereas, like, the best poetry is the other way around, you know, and the more you try and actually give it that space and delve in and do your
have your teachers. It, it definitely does, I think, make it seem less scary and kind of more, oh my God, this is so dense and great.
Poetry detectives.
Poetry detectives. Yeah, subtitle.
One thing I would say that I would recommend to anyone who's interested in any form of literature is to read Homer. Because that that is the start. No, don't say no.
Don't
say no. Is there?
Yeah, so you can get the graphic novel. But also, like, there's a new translation of the Odyssey by a lady called Emily Wilson, and it is brilliant. Mm. And there's an audiobook of it too, so you can listen to it and get a sense of the rhythm. It's written in iambic pentameter, so it lends itself really well to the English language. It's got that da-dum, da-dum, da-dum kind of rhythm to it. And that is really clever. It's really accessible. Nothing will go over your head. But it has influenced every poet and every writer out there. And I feel like you will get a lot more in jokes knowing a little bit more about the Greek classics. Also, they're really fun.
That's the one, Ur text. All right.
It's really fun.
All right, Mom, I'll read Homer.
I want to download the audiobook now.
It's really good.
It occurred to me to do that.
Yeah.
I think also, like, something that I've just, like, recently had a revelation about is that I just really like rhyming poetry. And it made me feel like I wasn't a poetry fan because I was but I'd like it better if it rhymed. And then now I've just, like, come to peace with it where I'm like, I just need to... Mm. Like, that is, like, a particular type of poetry that I absolutely love and I find it really clever. Mm. And then, you know, I do... Like, there's lots of poems that I like that don't rhyme, but I find myself really falling in love with the ones that rhyme, and that doesn't make me childish, hopefully.
Yeah.
I've just found out that I really like rhymes.
Yeah, and like enjoying seeing the unexpected connections between words that comes from the rhyme and kind of...
Yeah, and it's frustrating because you often see a lot of, like, you know, people who aren't really that open to poetry, especially modern poetry, be like, but it doesn't rhyme. It's not a poem.
Yeah.
And I'm like, that's also not the, the thing. But.
Yeah, I just always ask myself the question, does it sound good? That doesn't have to rhyme, it doesn't have to have a particular, like, regularity in the rhythm. Does it sound good?
Yeah.
That, I think, helps a lot.
Well, I had one more thing.
Oh, yeah?
Well, I just wanted to turn the little microphone back onto you.
Yes.
Because I obviously follow your social media accounts, as I'm sure everyone listening will have done, because it's great. And I notice that actually Leena is quite the poet herself. And I suppose I just wanted to ask you a bit about that and how you found that, and also how you married that up with earlier. You said that you were also scared of poetry.
Well, I am. And I think here's like a conundrum I'm going through. Is this big national debate about Insta poetry? And like, is this just a thought that I've had that I've arranged into the shape of a poem? Or is it a poem? And, like, I have been commissioned to do poetry before, and people do think, like, oh, that's Leena, she does poetry, I'll pay her for it. But I still don't really think of myself like that, because I'm like, I don't feel, again, because I don't always feel like I have a wealth of knowledge about poetry that I do. But then that's a big, like, Holly McNish has written brilliantly on this, and, like, talking about, like, accessibility of poetry and what makes you a poet. Mm. But I don't know what you guys think about Instagram poetry.
Do you self-define as a poet?
I think I'm trying to, but I don't.
You should. I've read your stuff.
Yeah, I really like your stuff.
But I don't. Again, it's like feeling like you're invited to the party, or that it's, you know, I don't know. Because I feel like if people were like, "So Leena, you're a poet. Who's your favourite poet?" I'd be like Philip Larkin, and they'd be like, "That's a bit of a basic, you know, like everybody likes Philip Larkin," and I'd be like, "Also like Carol Ann Duffy and Jackie Kay."
But they're... I was about to swear again. I'm not going to do it. They're fucking great.
Yeah, they are.
I don't feel like you should feel guilty about that just because you don't have, like, a hipster choice.
Yeah,
like,
it's true.
You know, like...
Yeah, because I just really enjoy it, and I feel like when I have thoughts, they don't come out in essay form or in any other way. That's how they come out. I think more people should be writing poetry just spontaneously. It should be part of everybody's, like, oh, yeah, I'm going to write a diary entry or a thing, or I'm going to write a poem.
A friend of mine writes a haiku for every day of their life.
That's
like
lovely.
A little diary entry. And I always thought that was... just so nice.
Every
I've never
day.
Read any of them, actually.
Does she just keep them?
I think she just keeps them for herself, like, in a diary, instead of, like, writing a, you know, a full kind of bullet-pointed entry or whatever. She just writes a haiku.
I don't know if that's really impressive
or really
a little bit
pretentious.
Creepy.
Oh.
I feel like when people are like, I kept all of my teeth from childhood. I'm like, impressed you kept track of them. But yeah, anyway, I think it's interesting to like think about like integrating poetry more into bookshops and therefore into people's reading experiences so they can just read poetry as part of their normal reading.
Yeah, and also in a like a guerrilla way, like Instagram poetry, like viewing also, it not as the kind of domain of the scary hallowed halls.
Yeah, and not having to jump so much into like, I am a poet, I am not a poet, therefore I don't write poetry, and I am a poet, so I do. It's like, oh, people can occasionally write poetry, or like maybe somebody wrote one poem in their life and they're like, oh, just, you know.
It's strange because it feels like poetry is almost both the most inaccessible art form and also potentially the most accessible. Because if you were able to make it into this thing where it's just like, oh yeah, my thought just came to me, like this really cool thought came to me in the like shower thoughts, and I put it in the form of poetry, that's far more accessible and shareable and able to be talked about in a kind of more open space than say, you know, oh yeah, okay, I had a thought about love and now I'm going to write a novel. Yeah, like that's far less achievable.
And also, I guess if you want to have a discussion, you're like, let's all read all of the Bronte, and then we'll get together in 9 years' time and talk about it. It's like you could all read a poem and then have a chat about it, and it's more.
My grandma actually has a poetry book club. Well, not poetry book club, but like
you are from a poetry family. I know.
It's in Dorset. If anyone lives nearby, it's in Dorset, and it's at this little coffee shop in Poole called the Red Roaster. It's a great coffee shop. They've got their own roaster. This is not an advert, but it kind of is.
Not spawn.
But basically, not spawn. But basically, they each they have like I think maybe 12 people, and they each just bring a poem that they've sent around in advance. So all you've had to read is 12 poems or sections of a long poem. And each person just talks about what they like about it. And it's really nice because sometimes it's they're really all nice. Like, oh, I'm really glad you showed me this. And other times they're like, that is a terrible poem. But it's fine because it's personal choice.
Yeah, and that's so cool. And then you get to discover all these new poets every time.
But I think with the whole, like, Instagram poetry debate versus, like, true, air quotes, poetry, like, debate, I don't think it really matters in the same sense that I don't think that Rachel Cusk is angry about Lee Child because a Rachel Cusk reader is different from a Lee Child reader, or you know, you can read both. It doesn't matter.
Like, sure, E.L. James isn't like, I can't believe now Scard has stolen all of my readers.
So, but I think for some reason people get a bee in their bonnet about poetry.
There's only room for one of us.
They somehow think that because someone's reading Rupi Kaur they can't appreciate Anne Carson or Alice Oswald. But guess what? Read all of them. I like all of them. So it doesn't.
That's your confession.
That's my confession.
Brilliant. Do you feel less scared?
Yes. I suppose if poetry is sort of the ghoul in the night, I'm sort of going to turn the light switch on and sort of gently go down the stairs. And I can just about make my way to the loo now, whereas before I couldn't.
And if anybody listening has any other suggestions of episodes we can do around things they're scared about, things they're worried about, like things that they're like don't know where to start with, we would love to hear your suggestions. So do tweet them at us at Vintage Books or on Instagram at Vintage Books. Consistent branding there.
Very nice.
And until next time.